you open your Bibles, I think it's to page 741, where Andy's going to read God's Word to us, and then we're going to sing one more song before we give God's Word to you.
Page 71. Isaiah 53, verse 1 to 6. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arms of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of the dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. By his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has sent on him the iniquity of us all.
We're just going to stand and sing Nothing But the Blood of Jesus. Let's stand and sing together.
What can one gain other than
I'm excited too, Helen. Let's have a time of prayer, shall we? Father, we just thank you, Lord, that nothing can wash away our sin but the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we just thank you, Lord, that we, in Isaiah 53, we can see, Lord, what you went through in order that we may have life. Lord, you were despised and rejected by men. You had nothing, you had no comeliness or great appearance that people should esteem you. And Lord, you were mocked and ridiculed and Lord, rejected, Lord. We just thank you that you laid your life down for us and that you would go through that, that we may be set free. We thank you, Lord, that that's why you came, to heal the brokenhearted, to set the captives free. Father, we just ask for forgiveness when we let you down, Lord. We just pray, just in this time of quiet, Lord, we just bring all of our weaknesses before you this morning. Maybe the things that we've said that we shouldn't have said, or maybe the things that we've done that we shouldn't have done, or maybe the things that we should have done that we didn't do. Father, we just confess our sin before you this morning. And we thank you for that promise that when we confess our sin to you, you're faithful and you're willing and you're just to forgive us, Lord. We thank you today there's no condemnation in Christ because we're in Christ this morning. So, Father, we just thank you for that promise, Lord. And we just pray, Lord, that today that you prepare hearts, Lord, in this place, Lord. As we talk about the subject of rejection, I understand, Lord, it's a very, very hard subject to deal with in our lives. Lord, it is in my own life. Lord, I just pray that we'd be open today for healing. Each individual in this place would allow the Holy Spirit to come to the depths, to the very depth core of our being and set us free, Lord, we pray. So we welcome you in this place, Lord, today. And we just bind anything that may hinder the work of God in this place. And we ask, my Lord, that you would cleanse the atmosphere of this place. Give us a freedom. Give me a freedom, Lord, to administer your word. Give us a freedom, Lord, to understand your word and put it in practice. Lord, we don't want to go out the same today. We want to be changed by the power of your Holy Spirit. We want to be changed, Lord. Father, change us. Help us, Lord, in this day, Lord, to have our confidence in Christ and our identity in him, not in what people say or what things happen around us, Lord, that our identity is secure in you. Father, make that a reality, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. As you can probably tell, I'm not really going to preach to you today, but I'm just going to talk to you today. It's kind of maybe be like a lecture. I hope it won't be like a lecture, but I pray that the Holy Spirit will speak to you as I talk with you. But can you see that? But don't worry, it gives you something to look at, so you don't have to look at me for 2 hours. Is that right? 2 hours? Now, what is rejection? Rejection is what results from a denial of love in your life. You all agree with that? When we're born into this world, each and every one of us need to be loved. I need to be loved. I love to be loved. Don't we? And when we come out, we like to be loved. So when someone throws something at us, or a wobbly or something, we're like, oh! And then all things seem to get, oh, I come out to be loved, and here we go again, another day where I'm not being loved. Do you feel like that, don't you? Do you know, Mother Teresa said it well. She said this, the greatest disease in the West today is not TB or leprosy. She had to deal with that stuff. But it is being unwanted, unloved, and uncared for. So true, isn't it? That sometimes we look at the physical diseases, but we forget the disease of rejection that's in our life that needs to be cured by the Lord Jesus. Now, God is love. You agree with that? It says that in 1 John 4, verse 8, whatever does not love does not know God. Because God is love. It says it twice, God is love. It's from his very heart. It can't be anything else. He is love. And that's God. And although we are separated from God, in a sense we're born rejected, by not rejected, but ourselves because of our sin, we're separated from a holy God, he sent his Son. And he's saying to you, look, you're made in the image. You're made in my image. I care for you. You have value. And I want you to understand that I love you. That's God's message to us. And so I think sometimes we cloud it with theological language. I know I do. But really, when I say at the counter to a woman, Jesus loves you, it's true. Jesus loves you. And I want that. If you get nothing from it today, you're valuable to the Lord and he loves you. Because when that reality comes into your life, it will push out all the other nonsense. It does for me. It takes a while. And I'm not quite there yet. But the more and more I realize God's love for me, the more it sets me free. Yeah? Now, Satan hates love. You know Satan was the anointed cherub that sat at the throne room of God. And he had everything going for him. But yet he chose to rebel against God. Therefore, God cast him down. And not only that, he cast out one third of the angels with him. And he is rejected. There's no going back for Satan. His fate is sealed. He will be thrown into the lake of fire with the beast and the false prophet. And all the other fallen angels that went with him. That's his fate. He cannot change that. It's sealed. So he's rejected. So he creates an atmosphere in this world of rejection because he wants to make you in his image. Because he's rejected, he wants to take as many as he can to the road to hell as he can by beating you up. And I know he can't take us to hell tonight because we're born again and we have Jesus in our lives, but he wants to make your life as miserable as he can until the day you get taken into glory. That's not Jesus' plan for you. His plan is for you to have life right now and in abundance. His plan for you is that you abide in him, that you bear fruit, and that you have joy, that your joy may be complete. Do you feel joy today? I'm praying if you don't, that by the end of it, there will be the beginning of a progress for you, okay? So how does the world deal with rejection? Now, the world, as you can see, like, just imagine the leaves, is all the issues we've got here. You see, you could probably understand some of them. You know, the outbursts that we have and where we get self-pity or guilt or we're inferior, we get defensive, don't we? We criticize. They're all leaves of rejection. And our world, the philosophy of the world, tries to deal with the leaves. So you go to a doctor and you say, I've got this problem, I've got depression. And they say, no, you just need tablets. That's what they do. I don't have to worry about them, that deals with them. I don't have to even talk about any problems in their life. I don't have to get down to the root of the issue because I just give them tablets. That's what the pharmaceutical comes to say that works. Off you go. Now, I'm not saying this. Some people need tablets. I'm not saying that. But that's the general prescription. They deal with the leaves. And even in some counsellors, they will deal with the leaves. And they'll try to say, look, here's the issue in your life. Just try to feel better about yourself and everything will go away. That's not getting to the root, is it? The root's not yourself. If you go down to the root of the issue, our hearts are deceitfully wicked beyond all cure. But yet, really, they can't get to the root. And that's what God does. He's saying to you, I want you today, and this is why I feel God has pressed the word rejection on my heart this week, is because I see it every day. I see the leaves come out. But I know it's deep-rooted. And there's so many people that suffer from it, I couldn't possibly counsel every single person because I just don't have the time. So I thought, I would then administer truth today that you would be free or begin a process of freedom in your life, okay? Root, that's where we need to get, the root of rejection. Can you see right down here? The tree going in here, the roots are going real deep down, and that's the root. And here is the reason, which we're going to talk about in a minute. Now Cain, do you remember Cain and Abel? Cain had leaves of bitterness and jealousy, and yet the repercussions for that reaction of rejection, what happened? He murdered his brother. Is that it? No, the root was rejection. Because Abel brought an offering, Cain brought an offering, but God rejected his offering. So he then suffered from bitterness and really hated his brother because he thought his brother had favoritism. But then he got bitter, and then that built up into hatred, and then he ended up killing his brother. That murder was a repercussion of the reactions of rejection. But the root was rejection. Rejection. So we're going to be talking about that. You know in the Bible it says, the axe is to the root. Lay the axe to the root. And that's exactly what you need to do to get... to clean the fruit up, or to clean the leaves up, you need to get to the root of the problem, and that means hitting it down at the bottom of the axe. Jesus used a good way. You know where the fig tree, cursed the fig tree. Cursed it at the root, and then they said, oh Lord, look, the figs are not showing on there because he cursed it right at the root. And that's what we have to do today, get to the root of rejection. You all understand? Are you all with me? Are you all with me?
Yeah.
Say amen if you're with me.
Amen.
All right, okay. Now, rejection is twofold. There's fear of rejection and self-rejection. A lot of these leaves spring from that, but that's the root of rejection. Firstly, fear of rejection is when a root of rejection goes deep and causes you to recoil at the prospect of future rejection. Yeah, so you put up a defensive mechanism around you. Yeah, because you're frightened of getting rejected again. So all these leaves are put in place because of that. But also, self-rejection is when you're wounded and you begin to reject oneself. And you would say this, if only I were different, I would be accepted. So all these leaves start to appear, yeah? So the root is rejection, and it can be self-rejection or fear of rejection. You got that? Now, firstly, we're going to talk about the reasons for rejection. Secondly, we're going to be talking about the reactions to rejection. And then thirdly, we're going to be talking about the repercussions from the wrong reactions and the wrong readjustments. I know that sounds a bit complicated, but as we go through it, you'll understand. Might take 5-10 minutes longer than normal, but it's important that we go through it, because what I'm going to be doing is hitting on some very deep issues in each of our lives. I've already hit on an issue in mine by doing this, and I thought, oh, that's me. So I just pray that the Lord will reveal that to you, okay? So here, let's just go through a few of them. You can see here, one of the reactions to a rejection is rebellion. You see that children, they rebel very early on in their life, don't they? And usually it would be because, here, look, let me read this. Newton's third law of motion gave science the maxim that for every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. Yeah? So in an experience of someone, they experience the offense of being rejected, falsely accused, neglected or abused by those who should have loved them. And so they respond by issuing an offense back towards them. So because they weren't loved, because they were misabused, they then rebel. It's like a counteract of the opposite to love, which is rejection. And that's, you get rebellion. And that's what happens. The books, when I read them, they talk about the hippies. I'm not having to go at the hippies, but that was from the very heart of what they did. They were very rebellious. And there's lots of different groups that do that. And usually it would stem from a lack of love or a lack of discipline growing up. And that rebellion flows forth. So let's move on. Second one here, bitterness. As you can see, Cain, because he was rejected by God, he formed a bitterness. You know that can happen in your life when you're grown up with a sibling. I know I grew up with my brother, and I used to literally, if he was sitting on my dad's lap, I would get him off so I could have the cuddle. You know, that's what I would do. And I'm not saying my brother has resentment, but that could have built up resentment against me, then caused bitterness, and that would then outflow in rejection and all these leaves. Yeah? Third one is self-pity. I'm not condemning anyone for this because I've suffered from it myself. I remember the very first time I came to church, I was very, very much feeling rejected. You come to church, no one loves me. Nobody loves me. Nobody's welcomed me. Do you feel like that? Nobody loves me. Nobody recognizes my need. Yeah? Is that feel? This was me, by the way. If only people knew my struggles. Life is unfair. Yeah? I mean, that's how I felt when I first come. So your eyes are looking inward. You're on yourself. Poor me. Why isn't everybody recognising the issues that I have? And I love this, that now I try to wake up to love, not wake up to be loved. There's a big difference in the way that you wake up. Sometimes you wake up to be loved. And if you wake up to be loved, you get disappointed, and then you have a self-pity party all the time. And that's it. So that's another one. Look, number four, escapism. How many people, when they feel so rejected, they go home and they can't cope anymore, they stick the TV on and they just sit there in front of it like that? I can't believe I've done that again, sorry. But it is, it's what they call it, Scout's mum used to call it bubblegum for the brain. That's not a good saying, is it? Bubblegum for the brain. But it is, watching TV all the time is escapism for some people. Yeah? I'm not saying there's anyone watching TV, I'm not saying that. Because I do watch programs, but another thing is movies. You know, movies all the time. I used to watch films all the time because I would escape my own reality. And then I would, in particular, love the really sad films because they made me feel better, you know, because they're really so sad. Me and Scout watched a film last night about a dog. And as a homeless man, he left his wife and his daughter. And the funny thing is that the dog died. He was so upset about it. And then he was reconciled with his daughter, and he was like, oh, great to see you. And then when the dog was revived, he was like, oh, I love it, it's so much. I was like, there's something wrong with this. The film showed that he loved his dog more than his daughter, but it does, them films, they make you feel better, don't they? Because they can be so sad, can't they? Alcohol is another way of escapism. Drown your sorrows is what they say. You know, sleep is another thing. Sometimes when I'm depressed, I just go to bed. Because I just think, I have to go to bed, I wake up, I'll be all right in the morning. All these forms of escapism is like putting your head in the sand, burying your head in the sand and saying, I hope it all goes away. Now, another one is guilt. Perhaps I won't go through all these, it might take too long. The guilt would be, for instance, let me give you an example. If your parents split at an early age, yeah, my parents split when I was 21, actually. But yeah, if you're a bit younger, sometimes, and I've had a chat with Scout about this, sometimes when your parents split, a child can grow up thinking it's their fault. Therefore, guilt would then come into their lives, and then they would feel guilty. And guilty, they would then self-condemn themselves, but they would also try and then transfer guilt onto other people, which would then be criticism and all that sort of stuff. So guilt can be really, really, really bad. You think of Adam and Eve, the moment they sinned, God was like, what have you done? And then Eve was like, Adam did it! Transfer of guilt. And what did Adam say? Oh, no, that was the other way. It was Eve did it, and then Eve said the serpent did it. You can see they felt guilty and ashamed, so they transferred the guilt onto other people. Be aware of that. Because us as Christians, we should be looking at our own lives, not looking at other people's. That's very important. So let's move on quite quick, because I'm hopefully going to spread it really wide, so it might touch everybody today. Defensiveness. You know they say when an animal gets hurt, it'll bite. And it's true with a person. If they're hurt, if they're suffering from a wound of rejection, be careful because they might bite. And we see it, don't we? So many people come and they can then, as I say, be critical, very judgmental. But what happens is you begin to build a false protection around you and you never see the faults of others. And then you begin to have a hardness. Now, God didn't make us with shells like turtles, did he? But sometimes we do, we put a shell around us and we won't let anybody in, we develop a real hardness. But God wants you to break that down. And that's number seven, is distrust and disrespect. Give you an example. A daughter had grown up and her father never gave her any love, never paid her attention. And yet he drank all the time and abused his role as a father. So that girl, when she grew up, had a distrust for men and also disrespect for men. So every man that comes across her life, she thinks is her father. Not in her mind, but deep from the heart, she believes. So that would then come out, disrespect and a distrust for men. And sometimes it would take get to the root of that rejection in order to set that person free, to say, actually, these people are not necessarily going to be like that. You need to start opening yourself up, trust God, and trust other people around you. So that's some reactions, yeah, you've got that. There's plenty more, and the Holy Spirit might be revealing some of them to you. But here we're going to be talking about a readjustment. Readjustment is where you try to align yourself to counteract that rejection that you have in your life. Number one, I read this in a few books, perfectionism. Perfectionism. What perfectionism does, it seeks to get approval from others. You say something like, I hope that in doing this thing perfect, I will get approval from these people, and then I won't get rejected. But also, when somebody is a perfect, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with doing good stuff and having neat things and that, I'm not saying that, but perfectionism where it completely clouds and overtakes your very being. But you would then expect others to perform equally as you do. And that's perfectionism. And it can be physically taxing, perfectionism. You're really trying to keep up with unrealistic and unnecessary goals. So that's perfectionism. Number two is false compassion and false responsibilities. False compassion would be, let me give you an example. Sometimes when somebody suffers from a spirit of rejection, they would like to have vulnerable people around them, because they like to help. But really what they're doing is they don't want certain people around them because they would be in fear of that person rejecting them. So they would be around people that they could help, people that would listen to them, people that would look up to them. And you see this, but sometimes it can be a false compassion. Another thing is, you see that with pets. Some people love, I mean, Scout and I love animals, we really do. But some people would see owning a pet, they'd think more of them than a human. Because why? Because pets, they don't reject you. We watched that film last night. Let me give you a story. We watched that film last night called The Secret Life of Pets. It was really funny at the start. All the dog used to do is wag his tail waiting at the door. And that was the whole thing. I'm just waiting, what are you doing? I'm just waiting for my owner to come back. And every little noise would be like that. Now, a dog will never reject you, but yet the cats were very much like, you know, only they wanted to be fed. Now, the bunny, all right, Scout wants me to talk about the bunny. You have this little tiny bunny, which is in the kind of evil camp, the rebellious camp. He's got a load of animals together, because one time they were rejected by the humans. So he's really, really, I mean, he's tough. I mean, he really is tough. He's only about that size, really cute. He's got this real deep voice. Now, he spends his whole time talking about eliminating the humans, killing them. Honestly. But at the end, he said, yeah, we're going to kill the humans, yeah. And then this little girl comes and picks the little bunny up. And then he's trying to hit her, and she's just like, oh, you're so cute. And he's just like, oh. And he just, oh. And she takes him in the house. Can you see something about that? I thought that was just amazing. I thought, just from speaking of rejection, I saw that bunny who has these leaves of rejection and wants just to take a bitterness and get a vengeance on the humans. All he needed was just a cuddle from a little girl. What? And love. And the moment he got love, he just was like putty in that girl's hands. Now, I will say this, that love is the answer. An environment of love, which we'll talk about in a minute. I'm wondering if I need to go through all these, I'm not quite sure. Let's move on. Materialism. Sometimes we can have a big vacuum in our lives that we go out shopping. I struggle with this one. I need the next newest iPad. I need the latest MacBook Pro. I need the latest clothes. And you go out and you try to fill that big hole in you by buying stuff. Let me tell you, that's not ever going to make you happy. It's never going to fill that hole in. I would say they say that the devil's substitute for joy is entertainment, but really it would be material lust, I think. Sexual lust. I won't go too much into that, I'll leave that one. Self-promotion is another thing. We try to build ourselves up because that's where we get our identity from. That's what society tells you. Society tells you that you have to be famous, that you have to earn lots of money, that you have to have a big house and a nice car. That's where you have to aim for, because I won't be rejected if I'm in that place. I've been in that place, and I was the most rejected I've ever been. Now I don't have that. that, and I have Christ, I'm well happy. Hallelujah. This is the one that got me, and I'm sorry it's taking longer, attention seeking. Now, those who know me during the week will probably say, yeah, Simon just seeks attention all the time. I walk and I trip myself up to make people laugh, I make meow noises and all sorts. And I'm thinking, okay, now am I doing it for the wrong, I'm not sure. Am I doing it to make people laugh, to make people sort of break the ice, or have I got rejection in me where I'm looking for attention all the time? I have to look seriously at my own heart. Because really, it was not just from that attention seeking. I dyed my hair electric blue, same colour as that paper there. I had piercings all over my face. As you can see, I used to have tattoos. Me walking down the street was like, I mean, before anyone coloured their hair, it was like, what's going on there? But it was because I wanted people to see me. Look at me. Attention seeking. Now here's the last one on the readjustments to rejection, is the control of others. Now here is your fear of being hurt or being put down, so you take control of every situation. Because every situation, if it comes out of your hands, you're not in control. Now every opposing view then to what you believe becomes rejection. So it's a knock-on effect. But also you can have that in the same way where your fear of losing something or someone, you want to hold on to it because you're saying, I don't want to be rejected again. So you end up controlling. Let me say, God is not controlling in any way. He doesn't control you, and he doesn't want us to control others. We have freedom in ourselves to do what we like, whether that's good or bad. God gives us free will. That's very important. Okay, there's that. Now, I know this might be a bit complicated. Repercussions to wrong reactions and wrong readjustments. That's a bit of a mouthful, isn't it? I'm not going to talk too much on this. It creates all sorts of problems. You can be imprisoned oneself. You can go and hide yourself away in your home. When you come out, everyone's a target for your woes, you know. Oh, I haven't, and are you right? Oh, well, I'm not sure. I had this and I've got that and this and that. And these are the repercussions of it, because you're constantly reacting. Now, one of the main things is, because of the way you react and the way you readjust, what you're doing is you're creating more rejection, because when you come to someone and you're acting like that, people are like, actually, I just don't want to be near you. So it's knock-on effect, and it's constant rejection. So what we do need to do is break the cycle, which we'll talk about in a minute. Okay, that's it. I've laid all the ground down. Now we're going to be talking about the remedy for rejection. If you know, there's a lot of bars in this, but I've got it from books, so there you go. Firstly, this is number one remedy. If you move that next one, Mike. It put teachable and open here, but it's a matter of letting the Holy Spirit identify how or where you have been wounded by rejection. So I just want you to think, because we'll pray, we'll all pray, give you a chance to pray and God to set you free. Just want you to think. Where? Now I can think where, so I'm with you on this one. Where somewhere down the line I was wounded, which then developed me to have rejection and create all these reactions. So firstly is allow the Holy Spirit to show you. I just want you to spend some time now thinking. Being teachable in the open, you might think, I'm okay. But actually God won't heal you if you think you're okay. You might be okay, I'm not saying you're not. But really just be open to the Holy Spirit showing you where you need to be healed. It's very important. Second remedy is forgiving the people that harmed you. When I counsel people, the main problem, period, is unforgiveness. Because until you, just think of Cain, if he'd have forgiven Abel, if he'd have accepted that, everything would have been fine. Would have sorted the issue out. Whoever's hurt you in the past, I want you now in your heart, you'll have some time to pray in a minute, to forgive that person or persons. Just forgive them. Forgive them. And it's an act of your will. Sometimes you feel that you don't want to, but it's just an act of saying, Lord, I release them to you and I forgive them. And just bless them. Pray for them. They may be dead. But still, you still have to forgive them and release them. Yeah? Number three, lay down the destructive roots of rejection, such as resentment, bitterness, hatred, and rebellion. In other words, it's repentance that's required. I've seen many people being delivered from rejection, but yet they go back and they just continue to live in the way they used to live. You need to change direction in the way you're acting. I know you can. The Lord will help you with it. But as we just pray that from today, you just be mindful every morning and say, I'm waking up to be love today, not to be loved. Because it doesn't matter who loves me, who doesn't love me, I'm going to love them. Can you do that? It's hard. But that's done me, served me very, very well. And everywhere I go is, no matter how people treat me, I love them. Yeah? Number four, accepting that God has accepted you in Christ. Firstly, as we read Isaiah 53, the Lord was despised and rejected by men. He bore your guilt on the cross. That means all your sins gone, wiped away. He bore your shame. Just think of if you're abused or anything like that, that's shameful to you. But he bore your shame. Just think, even the moment where they literally took his clothes off, he was stripped completely naked. That's Jesus. And he was on the cross completely naked in shame. Took your shame on the cross. But also that he was completely rejected by his own people. So Jesus has been through it all that you may be set free. So really the first place you look is where? At the cross. Even if it helps you to get a picture of the cross, it's very good to look at the cross and say, all my guilt, all my shame, all my rejection is finished at the work of the cross and surrendered to him. Yeah? It's very important. Another thing is I want to talk about that Jesus is the rock. Yeah? He's rock solid. I love that. He is rock solid. The gospel is rock solid.
You can still hear me.
Everything else around you will change. Circumstances, people, things that go around you, people might say the wrong thing to you. That will always go up and down. And if you allow that to identify you, you'll be up and down with it. You need to anchor yourself to the rock who never changes and tells you who you are in him. You know that I said to you that you are chosen before the foundation of the world, that you're adopted as a son by Jesus Christ to himself, you've been redeemed through his blood, you've been accepted, you've been raised up together and seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. It goes on and on and on and on and on. Jesus sees that you have value and he loves you by showing that by the death on the cross, but also by sending the comfort to you. Yeah? That's your identity, not what goes on around you. Yeah? It's so important that you recognize that and allow that revelation to come into you. But lastly this, and this is very, very important, and some of you will find it very difficult to accept this, is accepting yourself. Is that hard to do? Accept yourself. Because Christ has accepted you, accept yourself. I'm not saying think of anything more than what you are, or, but just accept yourself. Do you know God likes you? He does. Just think it's amazing. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to leave it there, and I'm going to lead you all in a prayer. Those who want to pray, you don't have to, but you can repeat after me. And then what I'm going to do is pray afterwards that God will just release you from rejection, if you have it. I'm not saying all of you do have it. But I say, if you're like me, you're somewhere down the line, you have suffered from rejection. Let me tell you that rejection can even come before birth, if your parents didn't want you. You can then be brought up thinking no one loves you. It could be anything. It could be a sibling that was born, you were born not so long after your sibling was born, and they felt, perhaps, how can we cope? Or we can't cope financially. Your parents. parents might have said that, and you've grown up with this deep rejection or resentment because perhaps your parents didn't really want you. So I just want you to just be aware of that. Whatever reason it is, whatever God is showing you, we can come before him now and he'll set you free. He'll set you free. So are you ready to... Have I led you in a prayer?
Yeah.
I'm wondering if we do it sitting down, just so nobody is embarrassed, nobody stands out. I just want you to close your eyes and bow your head. And this is nothing magical. What we're asking is to be open for God to come and heal us from the very root, which is rejection. And I'll be praying as well. So let's pray together. Just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God and the only way to God. You died on the cross for my sins. You rose again from the dead. I repent of all my sins and forgive every other person as I would have God forgive me. I forgive all those who have rejected me, hurt me, and failed to show me love. Lord, and I trust you to forgive
me.
I believe, Lord, that you accepted me. Because what you did on the cross, I am accepted.
I am highly favored.
I am the object of your special care. You really do love me.
You want me.
Your Father is my Father.
Heaven is my home.
I am a member of the family of God. The best family in the universe. I am accepted, thank you. I accept myself the way you made me. I am your workmanship. And I thank you for what you have done. I believe that you have begun a good work in me. And you will carry it on to completion. And now, Lord, I proclaim my release from any dark, evil spirit that has taken advantage of my wound, of the wounds in my life. I release my spirit to rejoice in you. In your precious name. Amen. And I'm going to say a prayer now here. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are here. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you have revealed the deep root of rejection in our lives. And I'm praying now, Lord, that you would just release them and deliver them from the spirit of rejection in Jesus' name. And Lord, that they would come into the realization of their identity in you, that they truly are loved. Lord, the truth sets you free. The Son sets you free. And we pray, Lord, that you would truly set everybody free in this place today. In Jesus' name. Amen. I'll just say this, if you want, anyone wants prayer, we'll have some people over here. But maybe you've sparked something up in you that you feel perhaps you want some further counsel, or you can always come and speak with me. I can chat with you during the week. But I thought the best hymn we could sing at this point is "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," because that's where your healing begins. This is the cross. So let's stand and sing that together.